I'm Rudy Alhouri, Dean of the School of Architecture at the University of Miami. Thank you for joining us tonight for our first lecture in the current series. We have two main public lectures in architecture. We have others also in other fields like construction management and real estate development. But the two in that focus primarily on architecture are the Technoglass series, which is on Wednesday, that focuses on professional practice, whereas the current one, the Monday series, is more broadly defined and eclectic. And this is where we have the opportunity to feature history and theory lectures. And tonight, it's going to be a more theory-oriented lecture that I'm looking forward to. Let me introduce our speaker tonight, Don Ruggles. As CEO of Ruggles Mabe Studio, Don Ruggles has been responsible for more than 1,000 projects and managed construction budgets totaling in excess of $6 billion. Under his direction, the firm has achieved an international profile, received multiple awards with a design process that blends time-honored traditions with the unique aspect of each site and the vision held by the client. Don is also invested in studies outside the private practice with a focus on classical and traditional design. He recently wrote the book, Beauty, Neuroscience, and Architecture, which investigates how timeless forms and patterns in architecture and design affect our health and well-being. The book was made into a full-length documentary featuring more than 20 professionals from around the world discussing the important role beauty plays in our lives. The movie titled Built Beautiful is due to launch on national public television in 2021, the spring, but actually has premiered just recently at the Denver Film Festival. Don is joining us virtually this evening to share his thoughts on this very topic. Please join me in welcoming him to our forum.
Beauty is in the brain of the beholder, and our brains are more similar than they're different.
I hate to break it to you, we evolved without buildings. And the brains and bodies we have arrive in the world expecting not to see buildings. We're really about living in the wild.
Beauty is not dependent on the human things, but anything that is described as beauty is described through the lens of being a human.
You respond to the patterns through your visceral responses, your biological responses, and the result is a wonderful experience that you feel biologically. You feel subconsciously.
The sensibilities of how our bodies feel comfort as we progress through a building, move in and out from one space to the next, that sense of shifting perspective.
Architecture is really more than just a functional space because we consume buildings, we don't experience building.
Clearly, architecture has ramifications on our health, and we need to understand what are the ideas that support health and well-being.
The urban environment matters for our mental and physical health. We need to empirically care about that and understand about it. And the exciting thing is we are starting now to have that public debate.
We need to respond to the people who are going to be using these places. And we need to study these people, and we need to analyze what's going on in their head, and we need to make that a big part of the design process going forward.
Good evening. What you just watched was the trailer for the recently released documentary film, Built Beautiful, a film that I and a group of international professionals developed to help illuminate the amazing research and information coming out of the neuroscience community today and how it's impacting architectural design worldwide. For centuries, man has sought to express beauty in art and architecture, and today neuroscience is helping us to know more about beauty and to understand how and why beauty plays such an important role in our lives. The title of today's talk is Beauty, Neuroscience, and Architecture, Timeless Patterns and Their Impact on Our Well-Being. So a brief overview of what I'm going to present this evening is, first, I will identify three basic concepts of neuroscience as related to art and architecture. Then second, that's followed by a discussion of an instinctual pattern and how it's connected to instinctual beauty. That's followed with a definition of beauty that weaves these concepts together with our health and well-being. And along the way, I'll share some personal experiences that helped inform much of the science that I've been looking into. And finally, I'll end the lecture with a short video that'll take you around the world highlighting some of these concepts. So today I'll start the talk with a question. Have you ever experienced a room that's unsettling? One that overwhelms the senses to the point of discomfort? Did you sense you had to leave as quickly as possible? Additionally, are there buildings or works of art that you routinely go out of your way to avoid? Conversely, have you ever been in a room that you didn't want to leave? Was it a space that calmed you and made you feel whole and nourished, even hopeful? Have you known a building or a piece of art that you went out of your way to engage with on a routine basis? So a more general question is, are we subconsciously aware of buildings that we routinely approach or avoid? And this is the power of architecture and design at work, and neuroscience is unlocking the ideas of art and architecture that have such an effect on us, whether positive or negative, and why they do. And frankly, it's an instinctual drive that we all share, our drive to achieve good health and well-being. So think of it this way. When you're ill, your primary focus is to regain your health. Or when you're under stress, your primary goal is to relieve the stress. This is common to all cultures and to all humans. It's beautiful is a phrase that we hear every day. It describes a quiet scene from nature, a moment of personal triumph. That was my grandson. I heard lots about that. A joyous event such as weddings or the birth of a baby. The majesty of a mountain range. That's a scene outside of Aspen, Colorado. And sunrises or sunsets. It's beautiful is an intuitive emotional response that implies inspiration, wonderment, awe, and curiosity. And at its most fundamental, a sense of pleasure. Yet this phrase has all but disappeared from the world of art and architecture. It's been marginalized to the point where it's seen as a romantic notion from a bygone era. Well, that is until recently when neuroscience started to unlock some of the mysteries of the brain and show us just how important the emotion of beauty is to our health and well-being. Well, the origin of this talk actually goes back to the early 1970s for me. And it's succinctly, it's a tale of two homes. I just had finished building a home in Aspen, Colorado, and I was standing in the great room and a neighbor came by and walked in, and it was her first visit to the house. And she looked at me and she looked around and she said, well, this is just absolutely beautiful. And I was 20 years old. I honestly had no idea what she was talking about. It seemed like a positive comment, but I didn't know if she was referring to the stone or the paint or the carpet or the view or who knew. But it felt good. So anyway, the conversation went on to other items and I didn't think too much more about it. Well, then fast forward about a year and a half and I completed building another house outside of Denver here. And I was invited to an event that celebrated the owners moving in. And I used a lot of the ideas from the first house in the design of the second house. So I expected the mood would be basically the same. Well, what happened that evening was really eye-opening. The comments were, this is interesting, this is exciting, it's so unique. And the mood was quite different than the mood that had been expressed by the woman that experienced the first house. And I wondered why there was no comment about beauty and why these two homes would generate such diametrically opposed reactions. Well, that question stayed with me unanswered until 2009, when I was asked to give a talk about timeless design as part of a fundraiser here in Denver. And the research for that talk led me to the Academy of Neuroscience for Architecture. And what I found there was completely eye-opening. And I'm going to share some of that with you. Well, here's a quote taken from one of the most famous architects of our time, Renzo Piano. And what's interesting about the quote is his use of the word emotions. This implies that he's familiar with information and ideas coming out of the neuroscience world, also the biology world. Well, this leads us to the first of the three neurological concepts important to today's talk. Here we have a cross-section of a typical brain, and most neuroscientists segment the brain into three major regions. First is the brain stem at the base of our cranium. Then there's the midbrain, which is immediately adjacent and, as the name implies, in the center of our brain. Well, these two regions together equals the ancient brain that evolved with humankind over, some believe, 5 million years. Well, this is the brain that our ancestors lived with as they evolved on the eastern plains of Africa, known as the savanna. And what's important for today's talk is to know that the ancient brain is the center of emotions, and that emotional thought happens subliminally without us even being aware of it. Well, then wrapping over the ancient brain is the third segment, the modern brain, believed to have evolved in the most recent 1 million years. And what's important to know about the modern brain is that it's the center of rational thought and feelings. Thus, to explain the diagram on the screen, emotions happen instinctually and subliminally in the ancient brain. And it isn't until the modern brain is activated that we're aware that the emotion is even occurring. And that awareness is known as a feeling. Well, here's a stunning fact for you to take in. 11 million bits of information per second enters the ancient brain. 50 of those bits per second are passed on to the modern brain and become feelings. So clearly our ancient brain is the neurological component that controls the majority of our actions and makes our lives possible. Well, it turns out that exciting and beautiful, the two terms associated with the homes I designed, are feelings that are the result of neurological inputs that are genetically encoded into our DNA. And these feelings are related to the two essential emotions of life: survival and pleasure. At the most fundamental level, humankind is genetically predisposed to seek two things: survival and pleasure. Every day, our bodies process billions of actions without us even knowing it. And all of them are geared to these two goals. An amazing 95% of all actions are processed by our brains, are intuitive and subconscious, and all are geared to emotions of survival and pleasure. Well, there are two very important feelings that result from the emotions of survival and pleasure, and those are avoid and approach. So a good example of these feelings are, I imagine each of you have said at one time or another, you know, I just don't feel like going there anymore. I don't know why, I just don't. Or conversely, I love going there. It's hard to put into words, but I just love it there. Well, these are subconscious emotions becoming feelings related to survival and pleasure. So this brings me to the second neurological concept important to this talk, neuroscientists have determined that our brains specialize in pattern recognition. And this too has to do with millions of years of our evolution. As Nikos Salangaros has theorized, those of our ancestors on the savanna, where mankind evolved, who most readily recognized repeating patterns, were the ones who survived. Literally, pattern recognition equals survival and pleasure. So a good example of this would be a dark sky filled with lightning, wind, and rain equaled stress and survival. This is a pattern to avoid. While a bright sky filled with sun combined with blossoms on a tree, leading to food and pleasure, is a pattern to approach. Or another example, jagged rocks and a cliff was a pattern to avoid. A green meadow with water was a pattern to approach. Well, continuing this pattern discussion, here we have a profile of a classic base, which we all know, but upon closer viewing, we realize it's actually the profiles of two faces opposing one another. So our brains are literally switching back and forth, attempting to decide what it is and attempting to decide, is it approachable or avoidable? Well, this is typical with how we regard everything we view every day. Our brain is constantly on guard for our survival and also seeking pleasure, approach or avoid. So patterns play an important role in our lives. Well, for today's discussion, a floor plan is a pattern, as is a building elevation, and a painting is a pattern as well, with colors and solids and voids. And a broad view is a pattern also, with land, water, trees, sky, etc. In fact, everything we view is known as quite simply as a pattern. And because survival and pleasure are the two drivers in our DNA, then humankind over time started to place repeating patterns into one of these categories. And these repeating patterns over millions of years during our evolution became genetically encoded into our DNA. And as a result, they were passed on from generation to generation, resulting in the common instinctual set of emotions that we all share. Well, each pattern we view is dominated by either approach or avoid. Now, this doesn't mean, though, that there aren't components of each in our view, only that there will eventually be a dominant response that you'll settle on. Well, here are a few patterns. Well, as we clicked through these patterns, your brain was instantaneously and subliminally deciding, is this a threat or is this approachable? So next, I'm going to show you a few examples of familiar patterns that we react emotionally to and discuss what the feelings are that are attached to these emotions. Now, before I show you the next few slides, I want to ask that you pay attention to how immediately you feel when the slide is projected. Not what you think of the slide, but just how you feel. This is the pleasure response originating in our evolution. When our ancestors came upon this view, it would be stress relieving due to food and shelter being available in the countryside. They knew that this was a good environment to raise their offspring in. It's approachable. It signals a subliminal intuitive reaction that equals pleasure. Incidentally, our clients often have an unexplainable emotional attachment to a view of this type. The reason for this is that it's encoded into their DNA as a pleasure-inducing pattern. Well, the next image generally creates a different emotional response. Conversely, clients often have an emotional reaction to this pattern as well. However, it's a survival and avoidance reaction. This is identifying a dangerous situation and a pattern. Well, this is a pleasure and approach pattern, a tree canopy, perhaps one of the first places of refuge for humankind, signaling stress relief and a feeling of safety. Here's a current day pleasure and approach pattern that signals protection and draws you in with familiar geometric patterns that is similar to the tree canopy. This room, too, is a refuge. Importantly, this room has understandable geometry, so our subconscious readily accepts that it's approachable. There's very little neurological stress generated by this pattern. Well, here's an architectural comparison that contains both pattern types, an approach geometric pattern combined with an avoidance geometric pattern. So notice how the avoidance pattern of the new construction overwhelms the approach pattern of the original building as your subconscious attempts to understand and find a category for this form. This is generally a stress-inducing pattern. And here's an image that contains both approach pattern and avoidance patterns as well. So normally a table full of food and wine and cheese in a meadow adjacent to a body of water would be an approach pattern. Yet the lightning has turned this into an avoidance pattern. So notice no one sitting at the table. They've frankly all run for the car. Here the survival instinct dominates over the approach instinct. The purpose of showing these last two slides is to show how the avoidance survival instinct overwhelms the approach instinct. Neuroscientists theorize that the avoidance survival instinct is actually 5 to 7 times stronger than the approach pleasure instinct. Why is it so much stronger? Because our brains evolve to protect us first and then to look for pleasure later. Well, this is an important fact to know as we look into the next step of this concept. This moves us to the third neurological concept. So we've been discussing subconscious neurological processing. And the brain has to have inputs to process, and those are provided by our nervous system. And because the discussion is dealing with subconscious processing, then it's the autonomic nervous system that we are dealing with. And the autonomic nervous system is made up of two very important and separable streams of information, and those being sympathetic and parasympathetic inputs. And these streams of information directly affect our health and sense of well-being, both positively and negatively. Well, sympathetic inputs are considered avoidance survival inputs, and they align with exciting. And conversely, parasympathetic inputs are considered approach pleasure inputs, and they align with beauty, as shown in this graphic. Well, following from that are some very important health attributes to be aware of here. Regarding sympathetic inputs, they are called sympathetic because these inputs are sympathetic to the fact that all bodily functions and resources should be temporarily diverted to the muscle groups that will enable survival. Thus, survival systems are at peak activation during a sympathetic event. Well, additionally, during a sympathetic event, non-essential systems are diminished, including reproduction, your immune system, and cell repair. This is known as fight, flight, or freeze reaction. And the major characteristics of a sympathetic event are stress and anxiety, which aligns with survival and avoidance. Two primary hormones released during a sympathetic event are adrenaline to activate the systems necessary for survival and cortisol to slow down non-survival systems. And the event initiates raised heart rate, elevated blood pressure, and it narrows your mental focus to focus in on your survival. And research has also shown that stress also affects our DNA and the longevity term of our life. So sympathetic inputs not only make us feel ill, they are a downward pull on our general health and sense of well-being. Regarding parasympathetic inputs, this is known as pleasure and approach. It's also called rest and relaxation or rest and digest. Characteristics are calming, stress relieving, feeling a sense of well-being, and the primary hormones released are endorphins, which is the feel-good hormone, and dopamine and oxytocin. The event initiates a lower heart rate, a lower blood pressure, optimizes critical functions and immunity, optimizes cell repair, activates multiple lobes in the brain simultaneously, which is when insight happens, and creates a sense of well-being. For those of you that practice meditation, it's parasympathetic inputs that you're seeking to access. So parasympathetic inputs not only make us feel good, they boost the general state of our health. So the core message here is that our subconscious brain is making decisions for us all day, every day, based on approach and avoidance patterns that we discern in our field of vision. And there are strong and clear health ramifications to the patterns we encounter, both positive and negative. Now, moving on from the neurological portion of this evening's talk, this leads me to the second segment I'm going to cover, how patterns are linked to beauty. As our research was progressing on the subject of patterns, we also started to observe a correlation in our work between the statement, it's beautiful, and the utilization of a 3x3 geometric pattern. So here's an example of a Georgian Federalist home that our firm designed. And what was interesting is when it was under construction, it was just a plywood box, and you could tell where all the windows and doors would be, and the chimneys, everything was just simply covered in plywood, no finishes whatsoever. People were walking by and commenting, oh, we can tell your house is going to be beautiful. Welcome to the neighborhood. Congratulations. Well, we knew that it had to be some kind of pattern because the finishes weren't influencing their comments whatsoever. Well, we of course knew that the Georgian home is founded on a 3x3 pattern. And we wondered, could this be the cause of their reaction? So we did a search of iconic, beautiful art and architecture worldwide on Google. And what we found was remarkable. And here are just a few of the hundreds of examples we found. Of course, the Parthenon, considered the most beautiful building in ancient Greece. And notice the red grid lines on the elevation correspond with the divisions on the plan, which are shown on the right-hand side of this graphic. And notice the 3x3 is used over and over on the plan layout of the building. Okay, next. The Pantheon, considered the most beautiful building in ancient Rome, and it too is a symphony of 3x3 patterns, including the famous marble floor. Villa Rotunda, generally considered the most beautiful residence built during the Renaissance. It too is a symphony of 3x3. Palladio, of course, used the 3x3 pattern, otherwise known as the 9 square, over and over in the compositions of his buildings. The Taj Mahal, generally considered the most beautiful example of Islamic architecture on the Indian continent. It too is a repetition of 3x3 pattern. The Forbidden City in China, generally considered the most beautiful building in ancient China. We trace this pattern back to 5000 BC in China. It's known as the Magic Square. That's the Neolithic period. That's at least 2000 years predating the pyramids. Falling Water, of course, considered the most beautiful contemporary home in America. And it too is laid out on a 3x3. Now, Frank Lloyd Wright learned a lot about traditional architecture, and his early works were certainly laid out on the 3x3. And he carried that through in his work into his later years. And you can look at the plan of Falling Water, and its root ideas are 3x3 diagrams shown over and over. Farnsworth House is recently deemed the most beautiful modernist home in America. Mies van der Rohe was schooled in traditional design, and he too used the 3x3 over and over. Rochamp, often referred to as the beautiful anomaly in the body of work of Le Corbusier, the 3x3 is on every elevation of this building, including the backside, which has numerous 3x3 patterns. Richard Myers Smith House, recently awarded the 25-year award by the AIA for beautiful design, it to its plan and elevations are all composition of a 3x3 root diagram. And the iconic Apple Cube in New York City is literally a 3x3 glass cube. And Apple uses this 3x3 pattern over and over. Foster, of course, is building the Apple stores now. And he uses that at the direction of Apple, no doubt. He uses the 3x3 diagram over and over to form their plans and elevations. And it's not just for building exteriors either. Here we have an interior fireplace elevation from a famous historic home showing the 3x3 pattern is used to establish the composition of a fireplace. It also applies to our iconic and beautiful artwork. Here's The Woman Gold by Gustav Klimt, often called the most beautiful modern painting in Western art. Also want to note that Michelangelo, Botticelli, Monet, Rothko, Hopper, Wyeth, Georgia O'Keeffe all use the same geometric model. And of course, the Mona Lisa, generally regarded as the most beautiful painting in Western art. Well, we wondered why there would be such a strong correlation between the emotion of beauty and the 3x3 pattern. And our research took us unexpectedly into face recognition science. And it comes back to this: the emotions of survival and pleasure, the two genetic drivers of the human condition. When a child is born, 65% of the neuronal structure of the newborn is dedicated to face recognition. As Charles Darwin stated, a child must find a face to survive. Well, the child is also driven to engage with the face, which results in bonding and pleasure. Because upon birth, the survival instinct is so strong, the child is frantically looking up and down, left and right, everywhere, searching for this image. A human facial pattern consisting of three dark areas defined by a light outline. This is the pattern that initially equals survival for the child. When they find this pattern, they know they can survive. It also equals pleasure, it turns out. Again, those being the two fundamental drivers of human life. So on the left here is what a child sees when first born and for a period of months thereafter. And note the three dark spots, the two eyes and the mouth. Well, the graphic in the center shows a geometric representation of the three dark spots. We refer to this as upper left, upper right, and bottom center pattern. And the right-hand graphic shows the completion of the 3x3 pattern. Well, here's the 3x3 pattern overlaid onto a traditional building, and then the transition to the same grid overlaid onto a face. Clearly, the building pattern and the facial pattern are similar. Also note in the traditional building, the two windows up high in the ground level door, this is the upper left, upper right, and bottom center pattern. And well, why is this important? Well, to quote Ellen Dissanayake from Art and Intimacy, newborns come into the world with sensitivities and capacities to predispose them to join in emotional communion with others. And these same sensitivities and capacities are later used and elaborated in the rhythms and modes of adult love, art, and architecture. This leads us to look into an important neurological development that occurs in the newborn. Bonding activates the neuronal path known as the mesolimbic reward pathway. And this pathway serves as a neurological conduit to activate the release of endorphins into the bloodstream, creating a sense of pleasure. Thus, for the rest of our lives, if the 3x3 pattern is perceived as approachable by the viewer, then it will initiate the empathic transference of emotions into the art and architecture that include this pattern. This is why much of our iconic, beautiful art and architecture is composed of the 3x3 pattern. As the result, of a core biologic response that all humans share, which is the drive to acquire pleasure. Well, this finding led us to an important connection between pleasure and our health and well-being. This information led us to biology and psychology. A healthy nervous system achieves balance when the flow of sympathetic and parasympathetic inputs is in balance. It's known as homeostasis. A life that's all sympathetic and stressful is out of balance, as we know. Likewise, a life that's all parasympathetic and pleasure is equally out of balance. Stress makes us stronger, and pleasure mitigates the negative components of stress. It's literally a balancing act where one input complements the other. A good example of this is a stressful workout at the gym followed by a cooling down period. That would be a homeostatic balance situation. In a recent article in the New York Times, a leading research doctor at Columbia placed homeostasis as the number one most important criteria to health and well-being. Well, applying the same balance between sympathetic and parasympathetic to design, we have this diagram indicating the importance of the utilization of design patterns that generate both parasympathetic and sympathetic reactions. Concisely, this advocates it's essential that both exciting and beautiful elements be combined in a design to achieve the proper balance to reinforce health and well-being. Now, keep in mind, as discussed earlier, sympathetic inputs are 5 to 7 times stronger than parasympathetic inputs, according to neuroscientists. And it doesn't take many of these inputs to properly balance the equation. Well, here's a good example of a modernist room that achieves homeostasis. The geometry, including the furniture, is organized in a 3x3 pattern, which is our brains easily decodes, and thus it is generally creating an approachable parasympathetic input. And then, as a sympathetic counter to these inputs, the colorful asymmetric ceiling fixture adds a layer of excitement to the room in just the correct proportion, which, as mentioned earlier, is approximately 1/7 of the volume. So spending time in this room would be good for your health and well-being, because the homeostatic balance is right. Well, an unbalanced accentuation on exciting and sympathetic patterns results in a diagram such as this, which leads to increased stress and a compromised immune and cardiovascular system, which can lead ultimately to catastrophic health ramifications, including inflammation, hypertension, high blood pressure, heart disease, stroke, and cancer are all connected to stress. And this in turn affects our autoimmune system and the very structure of our DNA that alters the longevity terms of our lives. Clearly a situation that we should strive to avoid. So returning to the room I showed you earlier, this is a good example of an unbalanced accentuation on exciting sympathetic patterns where the avoidance reaction is overriding the approach reaction. There is some comfortable furniture here arranged in identifiable pattern, but the overall geometry is unrecognizable, creating a stressful sympathetic reaction. Remember the picnic table with the lightning in the background? This composition has the same makeup. A few parasympathetic inputs completely dominated by stress-inducing sympathetic inputs. Concisely, this room would not be good for the occupant's health and well-being. And then returning to the other room I feature, this room is filled with patterns we recognize, including the 3x3 pattern and the upper left, upper right, and bottom center pattern. This room is sending a continuous stream of parasympathetic inputs. Soft light, recognizable geometry, flowers and water, all of these elements send approach pleasure signals. Concisely, this room would be good for the occupant's health and well-being. Returning to the home I showed earlier, the transference of the emotion of pleasure into a building elevation is a subconscious empathic event that results in the proclamation, "It's beautiful," when the correct patterns are in view. So note the 3x3 pattern that's the facade composition, and also note the two chimneys and the front door and portico. This is the upper left, upper right, and bottom center pattern. There are patterns, or these are patterns that the observers were instinctually reacting to as they walked by. So I will summarize what I just reviewed with you by using two very public and well-known rooms in New York City that both serve the same purpose. Here we have the main concourse of Penn Station. Perhaps some of you have experienced this. It's used by millions of people every day. There are virtually no pleasure approach patterns in this scene. The few there are completely overwhelmed by avoidance inputs. There's nothing here that initiates parasympathetic inputs other than maybe the donut shop. This is a stress-inducing environment. Conversely, here's Grand Central Station. The room is a symphony of patterns that the autonomic nervous system will respond positively to, including the upper left, upper right, and bottom center pattern and the 3x3 pattern. This is an environment that will reduce your stress. It's a powerful message that neuroscience is delivering. Architecture can directly impact our health and well-being, negatively and positively. Well, this brings me to the third segment of today's talk, a definition of beauty founded on neuroscience principles. Beauty has for over a century been considered to be in the eye of the beholder, that it is a personal preference decided by one's own experiences and judgments. Well, that was before the advent of the neural revolution. Now there's clear understanding that beauty is in the brain of the beholder, and that instinctual beauty is in fact a neurological event originating from the ancient brain as an emotion that transitions into a feeling affecting the modern brain. And those emotions at the most fundamental level are common to everyone because of our common genetic evolutionary history. So building on the concepts I've discussed, survival avoidance inputs, and pleasure approach inputs, this leads to a definition of beauty. And it's fundamentally a three-step process that we go through to call something beautiful. First, the brain contains chemicals that create an appetite for pleasure, and this fuels the mind's eagerness to search out new experiences. This is known as curiosity. Well, if curiosity should uncover a pattern that is recognizable by your subconscious and supports a pleasure approach reaction, then this leads to step two, which is anticipation. And this is when the mesolimbic reward pathway is activated, and this results in the release of several chemicals, including dopamine and endorphins, into your bloodstream, resulting in a feeling of well-being. Well, that leads to step three, which is the feeling of pleasure. And that feeling of pleasure results in the proclamation, "It's beautiful." Now, it's not a single cycle, though. It can be circular. Should the image be rich in multiple patterns, that you will go through the cycle again, and the result is the statement, "It's really beautiful." And then again, "That's incredibly beautiful." And then again, "It's unbelievable." And finally, "I'm at a loss for words," because at that point, your system is so full of endorphins that support your well-being that you don't know how to process it all. To quote Professor Harry Francis Mulgrave, beauty is a neurological activity, an urge for and feeling of pleasure emanating from the brain's lowest or most primal reaches. Concisely, instinctual beauty is a physical reaction to patterns that we recognize as being pleasurable. Well, I know that many of you are committed to beauty, and this is such important work you are doing, more important than you might realize. You are literally supporting and improving the overall health of society. and your future clients as well. So here's a suggestion. If a client ever pulls out a red pen and starts marking up your drawings, you might bring up the fact that their health and well-being is at stake and that they would do well to follow your lead. Not only will it improve their lives, it may very well extend their life. It is that important. And additionally, say to your clients, not only is it good for your health, beauty is free. Why wouldn't we use it? I do want to note that this talk has focused only on the facial 3x3 pattern. There are other patterns that humankind evolved with that are equally powerful. Patterns from nature known as fractals and curvatures from the human body, to name two. And our other senses are involved as well. And those will be left for another day to go over. Also, I will add that this is not an issue of what style to select. Patterns that support parasympathetic inputs and beauty can be a component of any style, as I have attempted to show. Rather, this is a quality of life issue and a public health issue. Science is pointing the way to understanding the emotion of beauty, and we should use this knowledge to better our world. Our clients' health and well-being will be the better for it. So I've written a book that details this theory with the supporting science, which I really didn't have time to elaborate on today due to our time. And the title is Beauty, Neuroscience and Architecture, and it's available through the Amazon bookstore. And additionally, as I mentioned earlier, we have produced a full-length documentary movie on the subject, and the title is Built Beautiful, with narration by Martha Stewart. So keep an eye out for that film. In closing, I'll say when someone says your work is beautiful, you should take a moment to reflect on the fact that you are improving their health and well-being at that very moment. Beauty does matter to our lives, and neuroscience has opened that door for us to step through again. Let's take advantage of it to make the world a better place. Now, before I show you the short video that I've produced, I want to say thank you to some very important individuals. First, to Dean El-Khoury and the entire School of Architecture team for organizing this lecture. I'm so grateful for your efforts. Then a thank you to Bruce and Martha Clinton, longtime friends of mine and supporters of this school, who helped to arrange this lecture. And finally, to Bob and Judy Newman. Bob and Judy have been longtime supporters of mine and supporters of the University of Miami. Judy is a trustee of the university and an alumni, and Bob is an honorary alumni. They too helped to make this lecture possible. So thank you so much to all of you. So for the final piece of this evening's presentation, I'll show you a short video that spans 5,000 years of architectural history, featuring every continent on Earth. And many of the buildings shown are deemed iconic. Many used new construction techniques of their day. Many were considered cutting edge design. Some are stone, some are wood, some are glass and steel. Yet despite this great diversity, they all share one single unique quality. They all are called beautiful. I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. I mean, we have everyone muted here but I'm sure you would have heard a lot of applause because of this very eloquent and beautiful presentation. Thank you very much. So while you were speaking, I was asking our audience to write questions in the chat box for me to relay. So I see several here that I would like to paraphrase. One of them is very long. I'm just gonna communicate to you the gist of it. So the question, I don't think it's a question, but it's more of a kind of a provocation prompting you to respond, I guess. Says that it seems like your argument is basically it's an apology actually for, it's promoting the principles of traditional and classical architecture that are aligned with the premise and the patterns that you describe. He says that though, when we look at contemporary architecture, there's so much going on in terms of what architecture can do. There is an emphasis on performance and how architecture can help in terms of the environmental impacts, how it can help with sustainability and resilience. And these kinds of projects have great impacts in terms of their consequences on well-being, wellness, etc. So he's suggesting that yes, we can look at those traditional patterns of beauty, but there are more urgent problems to deal with and to actually address, and architecture has this responsibility of dealing with those in terms of, by means of its performative power rather than its capacity to pleasure and delight. So what would be your response to this?
It's really not just about pleasure, it's about health and well-being. These are patterns that our subliminal brain is reacting to in an avoidance manner, which is creating inflammation and stress. So if you're creating architectural patterns that generate an initial avoidance reaction, then that is stressful. That is not good for our health. So it is not just about pleasure. It's about creating an architecture that supports health and well-being. Now, you know, certainly sustainability is an incredibly important concept. Green architecture, you know, functional, you know, spaces are all incredibly important. But what we've left behind here was the idea of beauty. And that what neuroscience has started to uncover is that beauty, as I just went through, is actually tied directly to our health and well-being. And I think what you can do is take the word beauty away, which ends up being a little bit, it bothers a lot of people, and substitute rest and relaxation, or if you want pleasure. You know, the pleasure component or the rest and relaxation needs to be a component of a design for it to properly support our health and well-being. And that is referring to homeostasis, which is the concept that I covered. So I certainly, you know, I'm not discounting all of the great strides that architecture has made over the years to support different functions and sustainability and green design and ADA design and earthquake design. And, you know, all those things are incredibly important. No discounting of that, but we need to make sure that the component of beauty is also part of the design equation.
Right. And I think actually the way you present the aesthetic argument as a question in terms of wellness and well-being actually is a very convincing argument, and actually is, I think, a contribution to the discussion in architecture in terms of the function or the role of aesthetics in the field. So It's a powerful argument. But while I here is another question. This one is shorter, so I can read it literally. If beauty and design is an evolutionary imperative and is encoded in our DNA, then it has to be accounted for as an equal to form and function. I guess it's not a question. It is a statement which resonates with your presentation. Thank you, Mike Peterson. One question I have is I'm wondering where does culture fit in your system? So if the apprehension of beauty is happening at those deep structural brain levels, can we speak about acculturation to beauty? Can we speak of the role of culture actually in beauty, or is it always at the fundamental deep level that we have to situate it?
I try to make a distinction between acquired beauty and instinctual beauty. So acquired would be more cultural related. So a group of people that learn to admire, you know, a certain pattern. In Islam, perhaps it's their tile patterns or patterns of geometry that resonate, you know, with them internally because they've grown up with it, and it tends to be a taught or acquired reaction. But I would say that there are subliminal patterns that resonate with all cultures, such as a sunset or a sunrise, or a broad view of an open meadow, or looking at the heavens at night. I mean, these are things that internally, you know, trigger our pleasure response, relaxation, and sense of well-being. So acquired beauty versus instinctual beauty, they're really two different things.
Right. Thank you for this clarification. I'm interested in that distinction, which was also part of the debates that go back to the 17th and 18th century period of history that I was very interested in, and continue actually to those discussions continue to grow, and neuroscience brings a whole other dimension to this. One more question before I turn back to the students and our faculty. Given, like you said, you just presented one aspect here, and there are so many others in terms of the patterns, and also given the progress, enormous progress made all the time now, very rapidly with neuroscience, then do you think that you will get at a stage where when we have even finer grain knowledge about such patterns and processes at the brain level, do you think that we will get to a point where we literally can crack the code of beauty, and then we can have AI generate beautiful buildings given that code?
There are a lot of people working on it. And my movies touches on this quite a bit. Colin Ellard from Waterloo University in Canada, a neuro aesthetics researcher, and also Anjan Chatterjee at the University of Pennsylvania are doing remarkable research in this. And I think they both say, you know, we're making strides. We have a long way to go. But learning to read the brain and what are the neural signals coming out of different kinds of spaces, and how do we use those as clues to inform decisions that architects give them a broad framework to help architects make a decision that has, you know, a foundation of beauty and rest and relaxation. So we're not there yet, but a lot of people are working very, very hard on it. And I think Anjan Chatterjee says we're probably about 5 years away, he thinks, from having, you know, a set of ideas that can clearly inform the architecture profession. But and also the Academy of Neuroscience for Architecture and the Art and Mind Institute at Johns Hopkins. I mean, these are all amazing groups of people working on this. And it's here to stay. Neuroscience is, I believe, here to stay. It will influence architecture going forward. It only is going to grow and become more fundamental to our profession.
Great, thank you. One last question here from Ellie. And so the question is, do you think there is any other way to look at neuroscience in terms of how it could help us, you know, think through architectural design and also the reception of architecture that is not about beauty, but maybe something else that neuroscience could bring to the discussion?
I would encourage you to go to the website for the Academy of Neuroscience for Architecture and look at some of the papers and the work that's going on there. Incredibly deep, thoughtful research. I think my presentation is more geared for architecture, so I'm trying to bring forward some ideas that kind of simply imply information that can be applied to architectural design. But there is some amazing research going on, and I would encourage you to take the time to look at what's going on at the Academy of Neuroscience for Architecture. It's in San Diego. It's based at the Salk Institute, and it's an amazing organization funded by the American Institute of Architecture. So they too, the AIA, is supporting this initiative that's taking the profession into the realms of science. And also, I would encourage you to read some of the work by Eric Kandel, a great neuroscientist at Columbia University. And he's not an architect. He's not tied to architecture, but he's wrote some amazing books and very readable, particularly one, Art and Insight, that would inform. I used a lot of his theories in what I presented today.
Great. Well, thank you so much. This is really an inspiration. We look forward to the documentary, but also I'm tempted now to take a look again at the book, which I actually have. And because I think you just scratched the surface here and there's so much more to explore with this proposition. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Enjoyed it. Thank you so much.